know.
400 views. Are there that many goalies in the state of California?
Okay, we're going, we're live, I think. I believe we're live.
It says live.
I'm going to get it up on the screen here and just get people on. We got
100 views. Are there any goalies in the state of California?
Oh, that was live, yeah. Okay, we're live. We got people joining us. I'm going to get Instagram going too. Okay, we got a couple people jumped on already. Let us know if you can hear us on the Facebook Live. Hey, Arinda, Joyce. Just want to make sure we're set up. We got Instagram. Oh, Instagram is paused due to poor connection. Hold on. That's odd. Let's see. Let's end that. We got a few more joining us. Great. Hey, guys. Just trying to get set up. I don't know what's happening with Instagram. Let's try again. Okay. Oh, maybe I need to go off. Maybe I need to go off. Oh, Nathan says hi. Nathan Fannin says hi, Darren.
All right.
I'm going to try to get, 1 second, guys. I'm just trying to get Instagram on. I'm going to turn my Wi-Fi off. Maybe that will help. Okay. Instagram is, still, I don't know, something's going on with Instagram. So we may not be able to get on Instagram, but we got it going on Facebook. We've already have 10 people joined us, so we're getting people rolling in, which is great. Welcome to Development, Darren Berezowski. We had a great response from the first session, a lot of questions and comments, and we actually didn't get through everything. So we want to make sure we get a part two. Darren, thanks for joining us. Mm-hmm. Anything you want to say to the group before we get started?
Well, I think this time, just because of the number of questions I received last time, I'll answer some of those questions. And then what I would like to do is actually make this a little more interactive. So if guys have questions while we're in this conversation, please ask them. And you could just send them in, Ben, you could ask them to me and I'll see if I can answer those questions. But one of the big ones that was being asked is, you know, in this time, what do I need to do in order to keep my skating worthy? By the time I get back on the ice, how am I going to make this work? So a lot of questions came up last time, and I'll answer a couple of them that I recommend. And one of them that was asked by several people is rollerblading something worthwhile? Well, I'm going to tell you right now, it absolutely is. And I'm going to give you a couple things that are there that happen when you rollerblade. When you rollerblade, you have, I believe, less likelihood of heel kick while you skate. One of the things I talk about is this heel kick and lack of efficiency while you skate. So when you rollerblade, you actually are pushing more to the side, which is what we talked about in the first session, is pushing out to the side. And you really can't get that toes coming down to the ice because the actual wheel of the rollerblades extends further than the front of the skate. So the only way you come back when you're in rollerblade is back to sort of what I call shoulder line. And that's a stronger position for you when you're skating up ice. So it's a really good leg strengthening one. In fact, I think it's awesome you would do that. And I would hope that you would focus in on things like trying to create more explosiveness when you're on your rollerblades. So number one, yes, rollerblades, great. Go play around, go mess around. It's great hand-eye coordination that goes on when you're playing around with a ball. Focus on your skating, which is good. And one of the things that you can try to do is try to, when we're rollerblading, and it's one of the hard ones, it's difficult for me when I rollerblade, is to be able to actually turn a tight turn. Work on that one. That takes a lot of leg power, takes a lot of strength, and really forces your body weight over your rollerblades, which you have to do on ice skating as well. And I'm going to address some of the ice skating issues today that we talked about in this one thing called transfer of weight. It's a misunderstood. It's not really discussed a lot by coaches and players or skating instructors, but it's an important one because we transfer weight and there's a couple ways that it's disguised. The other thing about being ready to go when the season starts is doing the off-ice training. You must, and it's an absolute imperative, and I've seen the best skaters, and we're going to talk about the best skaters in the NHL. There's something very important about you developing this strength in your legs, because as you strengthen your legs, your ability to move on the ice, your ability to control your edges are higher. Now, some of the things that we talk about on the last one, we talk about a wide skating stride, we talked about inside edge, we talked about transfer of weight, and we talked about a toe snap. These are all the dynamics that go into a proper skate. And in that, the great skaters have something greater that they do that allows them to be a smoother skater, but at the same time, hold their edges and be deceptive. So when I say this idea of deceptive, what makes you deceptive? It means that you're disguising or you're changing how people read you. So if I'm coming at you straight on like this, but I had the ability to jut out in a certain direction or fake like I'm going this direction and cut back, it has a lot to do with what I call messages you give or signals you give. And at the same time, we use things like our sticks, our shoulders, our heads, we do it, but it's still going to happen in your skate blades. And we will use inside edge, outside edge. And I'm going to give some examples later today of Sidney Crosby, Evgeny Kuznetsov. These are great skaters and they're giving false information. I bring this up as something that we talk about all the time in hockey. It's giving a message, but you're really intending to go another direction. So that's one of the things that came up. So hopefully I'm answering your questions about how do you get to be game ready when the season starts.
Aaron, what about when they're on their rollerblades and things, is what about skating up hills and stuff? Is that good or is that bad for the stride length and things?
No, I actually think all of it's good. And here's my thing. I don't need you to go up a hill that's a 2 mile run. You go up a hill in what I call explosive. So start at the bottom of the hill and you work your way up and try to get 10, 15 really powerful, quick pump, 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 pump strides as you go up the hill. There's a pressure put on the body. There's a lot of resistance in the wheels. This is still important for your leg strength and development. And if you're striding properly, you'll still have some back kick, but there's no way you're going to get that toe kick that comes forward, because if you do, you're just going to struggle going up the hill. You've really got to push back and powerful.
Right.
One of the other questions is that came to me was, we talked about this idea of speed and on the ice. And so a couple of questions came along this way. How do I improve my hockey intelligence? We call that hockey IQ. I have a couple things that I say. Yes, speed is important. But the reality is that there's two other things that come to play in this thing. And you're going to have a certain intelligence that is sort of what we call the God-given intelligence. You're going to have a certain way of reasoning on the ice. But speed plays in your favor, because here's a question I ask you is, do you make better decisions under pressure or do you make better decisions without pressure? Most people, and I would say it's almost 99%, make better decisions without pressure. So how do you get to a place where you can make good decisions and increase your hockey IQ? I say utilize speed. And today, the videos I show will show you what speed does, what maneuvering and the ability to give false information on your skates, and what is happening while you're skating. What does that time, we're going to space and time, if I call this space and time relational, that when you are under pressure, that means that somebody's taking away your space. When you have the puck and you're under pressure, somebody's taking away your space. So the idea here is to create space so that you have time to make better decisions. And as you get into the practice of creating space and creating time, you make better decisions, and then it multiplies. And in time, really the big picture in Hockey IQ is that you're making good decisions under pressure, not just because it's under pressure, because you know how to get out of pressure and create opportunities. And that's one of the reasons I pulled the Sidney Crosby video up. He does it all the time, and he uses multiple skating techniques in order to get there. So that's kind of a couple of the questions I had. There are a couple others, but they're minor. I'll address them as I come along.
Yeah. Shane Scott says, hi, Darren. And they're on watching too. Do you want me to pull up one of those videos right now?
Yeah. Let's go to something. And I'm going to touch on something when we talk about, and hey, Shane, good to see you're on here. And I'm actually really thrilled that young players get on this, because some of the things we talk about are going to progress you further than just going out and skating. Because if you see the big picture, you'll understand something. And the big picture is we're really in this game of hockey. And I say at the end of the day, you know, how do you win in the game? How do you win in a game? Well, it's really the team that scores the most goals wins the game. That's it. Doesn't mean they play the better game. Doesn't mean a lot of things, but whoever scored the most goals. So in there, you've got to create opportunities and take away opportunities. There's space and time in all of this. There's an intelligence that goes on. So I think that when we go through this, you're going to see some things in these videos. You're going to go, oh my gosh. And you can adapt to your game. So great. So yeah, why don't we do the first one with Evgeny Kuznetsov, and maybe just hold it before we start, just set it up, Ben, and then okay. I'll talk through it. And then talk about what goes on.
Okay. I'm going to get this up, guys, here. And while I'm doing this, guys, for those of you who find value in this, there's a lot of people that are going to watch this in the replay. You can let us know your questions or comments in the replay as well, and we can get back to them. And then if you find this valuable, we really appreciate you sharing it on your page so that others can see and watch this presentation as well. Okay, let's see. I think, here we go. I'm going to share the Kuznetsov video. And Darren, okay. Can you see that?
So it's queued up. So let's anyway, this the highlight reel. So just put it just ahead a bit, Ben. I think it's at 27.
Got it at there, 27.
Okay, so let me explain the situation. Washington Capitals have a power play. They're in, this is a few years back in the Stanley Cup playoffs, and Columbus Blue Jackets and Washington got a lead. Actually, Kuznetsov set up the first goal. And it was a great series of a pass. And then he worked his way through the zone. But what I want to show here is a skater that's using their edges and the deceptiveness that comes when you use your edges correctly. So Kuznetsov is going to go to the neutral zone. He's going to start down low on the bottom of your screen. And so what's going to happen is the play will set up, the defenseman will go behind the net, pick up the puck, and he'll go behind the net, and Kuznetsov comes very low. So we talk about this all the time as coaches about setting up the power play. And there's something invaluable of coming up as a unit. So the Capitals show they come up as a unit. Well, there's not all players. There's one player that plays up ice, and we'll get to that in a second. But they come up as a unit. Kuznetsov will get the puck. He's somewhat in stride, but if you watch how he started out, he was almost coasting. And he gets up to the wing and he gets the puck. And watch what he does from about just before the blue line right into the zone and how he sets the defenseman. And just so you know, you have both a world-class defenseman and a world-class goalie in Bobrovsky in net. These guys know their positions. They know how to gap up. They know how to set guys up. But they were being a bit mystified by Kuznetsov because he did something. And I tell guys, practice your C cuts. C cuts are probably the most deceptive part you do. If you watch Patrick Kane, he C cuts when he comes in the zone with those fast hands, and he stops himself with his edges and he speeds himself up and he creates different tempo. And so when you C cut, it's hard for a defenseman to know what you're doing. They can't really read the play. As soon as you get into certain situations as a skater and you lift the foot, now the defenseman knows you've got to go that way. Once you lift your foot, I can take you off to the side. But in this particular case, Kuznetsov comes with C cuts. But watch this. He doesn't slow down. Okay, you can run it, Ben.
More firm, more assertive in his game right now. That's why they
and there's Kuznetsov at the bottom of the screen. He gets a pass by from Laura.
Kuznetsov, beautiful.
You want to pause it and keep going?
Keep going because we'll watch it. It's going to show him coming head on. As you saw, that was a goal. And he, what he did is he made a move with his stick. He did a far watch, went to his backhand, back to his forehand, all in one motion shot. But the impressiveness is what he's doing with his skates. That's good, Ben. You can pause it there. So a couple things. It's hard to see. I don't know if everybody can see it. Please give feedback because it seemed a bit jerky on the video, Ben. But Kuznetsov uses his C cuts. He comes into the zone. But look at what he did. He almost went straight on to the defenseman because he knew the defenseman was backing up. But he really didn't. He was faking him coming from the outside, faking him. He was going to the inside, which set up both the goalie and the defenseman leaning one way. And then he does a massive backhand to forehand. He's a lefty, backhand to forehand. Yeah, and go back a little further. Which now it's all in edge work. You can do it with your stick, but his skating motion is still moving forward with acceleration. And he changes it so quickly. Backhand to forehand, and it's all in one motion shot. It fooled the goalie because the goalie had to slide across to set up from backhand to his forehand, and then he went inside post in. And the impressive part is the speed in which Kuznetsov came. He really wasn't gathering a ton of speed coming through the neutral, but he had some speed. But really what happened is his C cuts into the zone forced the player to overthink and try to guess the play. You can show it again from start.
Sure. Yeah, he didn't even lift his skates once he got in.
He went C cut straight into the guy and yet fooled a world-class defenseman, world-class goalie. Here it is, Kuznetsov's at the bottom of the page. He does a little couple turns. He's going so-so. So he gets it in speed, comes in stride, C-cut, maneuver. And he probably, my guess is he went 10 to 12 feet with his stick. His feet moved 4 to 5 feet in one motion. Woo! Woo! Back shot. I love that shot. I love that play because he protected puck. He didn't expose the puck to the defenseman. The defenseman had no choice in this situation. And had to back off because of the speed Kuznetsov had come with him. And they were on a penalty kill, of course. But the fact is he came with speed and was deceptive and moved his skates. His edges were so precise. And look at that. Hardly any time left in the period. And that was in a power play. They scored 2 goals in that power play. So if you have any questions, put them in. Then we'll go to another video clip to talk about edge work.
Jordan Verderami and Anna Engel say hi, so they joined us as well.
Yep, perfect.
No new questions yet. Do I keep going with this video, or do we go to a...
Go to the next one. Go to the next one with Sidney Crosby.
Okay.
So in this particular case, he showed C cuts coming into the zone, just so that we're in this conversation. He showed C cuts coming into the zone. And the power and speed, his edge work was so strong. His feet were wide. His motion in his body allowed him, if I'm going like this, it allowed him to fake through the defenseman by the shift of his weight. But he kept grounded over his skates. He had full control in what he was doing. He's a beautiful skater and underrated as a skater because he's the second line center. Nicholas Backstrom is the top center. And we can show tons of Nicholas Backstrom skating too. So here's a face-off. This is Ottawa. playing Pittsburgh in the Stanley Cup playoffs. And we're going to focus in. You can run it, Ben. What we're going to focus in are the number of cuts Sidney Crosby does. And he's got a world-class player, Jason Spezza, marking him. Watch it through. Here comes Sid the Kid. He picks up the puck here, 87, down low. Spezza's on him. Whoop, he cuts back. Look at the Mohawks. Cuts back. Now he's going up. Whoops, he cuts back again. Cuts back. One more time. Then he comes up. Now he fakes the front of net, moves it to the point. Point, walks the line, shot. Pretty impressive. He mesmerized an entire team. This was a 5-on-5. Now the keys are going to show up on this next part of the video. Sidney Crosby uses these cutbacks. If you watch, he's got inside edge and he's got an outside edge engaging when he goes narrow foot. When he does wide, he's moving away from Spezza down toward the boards. He does Mohawk. That Mohawk is still edge work. He spreads his legs and he, if you watch, it almost looks like he's hovering down low and he zooms around, but he has sight line on the ice. So just hold on for a sec, Ben. We'll get there in a sec. He's got sight line on the ice. But what's key is he's looking at all his players. His back is to the play periodically, but when he goes into that place where he's looking up ice, he's checking out where all the guys are. Watch the second turn he does after he goes behind the net, cuts back and does his second turn. He's already looking up at the point, Letang. He knows Letang is there, and he's still going to do one more cutback and come back out, knowing he's going to fake toward the net to freeze all the defensemen, and then he moves it to Letang. This is a really awesome play. And he saw every player he had on the ice and knew the options. Again, starting with my original conversation, why does speed matter? Why does skating matter? Because it allows you to open up space, which gives you time and allows you to make good decisions. Yes, he is one strong guy. People talk about how hard he is to knock off the puck. And on another time, I'll show him and Brad Marchand going at it to get the puck. And Sidney Crosby wins at all of those battles with Brad Marchand. As good as he is, he wins at these battles because he's so strong in his lower body and his knees stay bent. Very important. That knee bend is critical. It's like shock absorbers on the skates. Okay, run it, Ben. And then this time, let's go past into the highlight after.
You want to see that again?
Well, let's just go to the highlight after. Keep running it. Okay. There's Sid going this way. Now he stops. He goes back the other side. That's his fake. Okay, sorry. Yeah. Let it roll out. Let it play out. Hey, no embarrassment for Spezza. He played well. He blocked up. He used his body to prevent Sidney Crosby from coming to the front of the net. But it didn't matter. Sid was so elusive here. Watch the highlight. Sid comes up and gets the puck. He goes down. He protects with his shoulders, arms. Look at his legs. His feet are moving. His hands are always keeping the puck out in front. Now he cuts back, but he looked up. He saw the point. He cuts again. He looks up. He knows where he's going. He knows, and Letang knows it too. Top shelf. It's such a fun goal because I just think there's so much set up in what Sidney Crosby does. He plays below the line, and he will be one of the first. You can pause it here. He'll be one of the first. Oh, okay. You can play it because it's a little slower. This is the slower one. Watch. Mohawk, stick handle, move, pressure fake. He looked up. Focus again. He's looking up, looking up, looking up, looking. Oh, there you go. There was another player in the NHL that made a living. They used to say behind the net. He was famous for it. We actually named this after Wayne Gretzky. Well, here's another guy that makes a living below the red line, long behind the net. He works it out of the corner. If you watch Crosby highlights, you'll see most of his plays, almost all of his plays, start down low when they've got zone possession. So we go into these battles and we practice battles and practices, guys. You've got to fight for this stuff. You got to protect puck and do whatever you can. And you don't need to go skating all over the ice. And we do one-on-one battles and on the ice. Battle in tight areas. That's where you're going to learn more about your skating. and what you do. Because if you watch Sidney Crosby, he actually exploded out of a turn. Cutbacks, a lot of people stop. They don't have the edge work. So this is what I'm going to get to, is why I focus in on C cuts. C cuts are forcing you to create explosiveness without using your entire leg. It's in your ankle. It's in your feet. There's an edge that goes. You've got to pound that skate into the ice. The more you create that motion into the ice surface, the more explosive it comes out of that area. So hopefully this is making sense. And we can run it one more time just on the last little bit of the clip. And just watch Sidney Crosby. He creates space when he goes back and forth. He's creating space.
Oh, yeah, he goes forever.
Right, and he cuts back and space is created. There he is. He goes ahead. So Spezza's right on him. He cuts back, protects puck, moves away. Spezza can't get to him, but he's on him. Cuts back, explodes away. Then he cuts back one more time. Every edge is working for him. It's incredible. And he protects the puck.
Can you explain how C cuts and that foundation of skating, you know, allows for even, you know, for the Mohawks, the tight turns, that kind of the stops and starts. How does that relate to some of that specific stuff that he's doing there?
Well, if you look at what he's doing, is if you look at the number of strides he actually does, it's limited. He's in a very tight area. And the other thing we forget a lot about hockey, because a lot of people practice drills, but those drills aren't under pressure. He has a player on him all the time. That player, watch Spezza, he's putting pressure on Sidney Crosby. He wants to knock him off the puck. Mm-hmm. But because Sidney is so stable, for most of your parents, when I go down this road and I talk about the importance of wide stance, deep knee bend, weight centered over your skate blade, it's for this very reason. The game is not played in a bubble. It's not played without pressure. Expect the pressure and learn to accelerate and move out of pressure with speed, because you've got edge work. And once that starts to happen, now you become a threat. And this is what I want to sort of bring to mind here. And you asked the question, Ben, why are C cuts important? Because it forces you to try to figure out strength within your body and within your feet. Here, I'm just going to give me a second here. I'm just going to do something real quick and try to explain something. Hopefully everybody can see this. Yep, so when you're on the ice, I want you to think about something.
Hold on, let me make you bigger here, Darren. I'm going to stop my screen share for a minute. Mm-hmm. Whoops, wrong thing there. Hold on here. Hold on, where can I? There we go. And I'm going to make you bigger. Okay.
I can show it this way. That way I can. Is everybody, you can see my screen, Ben?
Yeah.
Okay. So I'm doing this way because I want to show something. I have watched players in the NHL. And let me tell you guys, I'll do it this way. Let's say this is the surface of the ice. I've watched them do warm up with skating instructors, but they do this. Let's say this is single leg right. They will skate up, single leg right, do a full circle, single leg right, and continue on full circle, single leg right on their outside edge. Full circle, come up, single leg right, inside edge, and they never, never, never put their foot down. They'll go all the way around the ice. You guys seeing this? All mm-hmm. the way around the ice and come back here. Their legs are burning, guys, but they do not take a stride. They don't put a foot down in the ice. And some of you guys that have come skating with me on ice know that that's part of my warm-up routine. I want you guys to figure out how to create explosiveness. And everybody thinks, oh, And I'm sure you guys have heard this story. Oh, I'm really good once I get a couple strides. Skip that. Get really good on their first stride. That's why Connor McDavid, and I haven't even got to the Connor McDavid. I got Matt Barzell. I got Connor McDavid type stuff. I got Sergei Fedorov, or forgot him last time. He's another unbelievable skater, but these guys can manage. And Austin Matthews, I've got a goal where Austin Matthews, I can erase this for a second. You guys understanding where I'm going? Single leg, practice on it. You get on the ice. See how much work it takes to get somewhere on the ice, single leg, and how far you can get. I'm going to give you, actually, before I get to the other one I'll get to, I'll even challenge you with something simple. When you get on the ice, do things like this. Work your leg, single leg, inside, outside, inside, outside, inside, outside, single leg, skate. Never put the other skate down. How far can you get? Can you do it? Most guys can't. The biggest reason? They don't know their edges. They've relied on the strength of their legs pushing them through. But all the great skaters, it's in the foot. Now, I'll give you an example of something I watched, and it was a really awesome example of pressure and power. So you asked the question, Ben, about C cuts. So here's a play. NHL playoffs a few years back. Toronto playing Boston, and at the end of the game, at the end of the series, Boston wins, but a goal. Austin Matthews, I'm sure you all heard of him, number one draft pick, Arizona, right? What has he got in his area for hockey? Very little at the time. But he's coming in the zone. If this is the blue line, he came in the zone, and I'll try to find this highlight. He comes in the zone, and he's got this guy by the name of Zdeno Chara. I don't know how long Zdeno Chara's reach, but I'm sure he's got a 12-foot reach with the stick and the power, and he's considered to be one of the strongest guys in the NHL. The net was here. Tuukka Rask was in net. Right about here, just at the top of the circles, Austin Matthews had Zdeno Chara on him, pushing him like he was about to push him into the boards. Austin Matthews, from about here, went single leg left. He's a left-handed player, and he cruised all the way around. He found power in that single leg, left, 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 left. He ended up coming to the front of the net, which made him lose Zdeno Chara because Zdeno couldn't keep up with a guy on a single leg skate. He took a shot here on net and was followed up by another player. I think it was, I can't remember who got it. Could have been Nystrom. Got it. But they picked up the rebound because Austin Matthews got the puck to the front of the net. Single leg, C cut, one leg, all the way around. He put the pressure on one edge, held an edge, and created power. I can show that one on another one in the near future. But hopefully that gives you guys an idea of what we're doing and why I'm kind of a stickler on it. I believe it's going to be the difference between you getting checked off the puck or not.
Great. And so, Darren, how much – so you talk about, the single – developing each leg, right? And then developing the strength down on each foot and each leg on the C cut. But then also oftentimes having both legs, having that strong stance, that strong wide stance, and having both feet on the ground a lot of times too. So is it training single leg a lot of times, but then staying in that stance a lot of times throughout the game?
Well, the answer is yes. You must train individual legs and you must get strong on that single leg. There will be times you'll be forced into a single leg position that you won't think you're going to need to worry about. And it could be, for most people, we have a dominant leg. Perhaps for most, it's the right leg. Science tells us it's that. So that means you've got to work as hard, if not harder, on your left leg for strength. That left leg has to catch up to the right leg for strength. And then the other thing about that left leg, it's often, and it for a lot of you, just check yourself out. One of the things that we tend to do is we tend to push off the same leg every time. Regardless of the position of the puck, we need to learn to be coordinated and powerful on both. We can't rely only on your dominant leg. Sometimes the difference between getting a puck, if the puck, let's just go for example, if I need to go to my left, I could push off my right foot, do a crossover with my left foot planted and head to the right, and that would allow me to get to the puck pretty quick. Okay, now let's go to the right. What am I doing? If I don't have the power in my left leg, what it means is I'm only doing a half step. I'm only getting a portion of power because I'm going to go outside edge right leg with a partial push on my left leg because it's not strong enough. What are the odds of me getting to that puck? What are the odds? And I'm going to say I'm a lefty. I'm moving this way. Well, now I'm on my backhand trying to get to a puck, and now I don't have the speed or the power to get there. So, yes, you've got to put as much power and speed and explosiveness in that left leg as you do with your right. It will help you, especially where's our weak side of almost every player in hockey? Two weak things, probably our left leg because you have a dominant right. I do get the odd kid on treadmill that has a dominant left, but also – if you're going to your backhand, you better be really powerful on your edges to get to your backhand so you can go around guys, because most guys stop their feet. Instead, if you go back to Evgeny Kuznetsov, he actually kept his feet going with C cuts, went to his backhand, quickly pulled to his forehand, and snapped the shot all in one motion.
Yeah. Ken, can you talk a little bit? We did it last time a bit, but you know the difference in the old school game, which is the skate straight up and down in a straight line a lot of times. And then, you know, and then the kind of the older school way of teaching skating, which was a lot of long leg extension on the a lot of focus on the stride, driving your arms forwards and driving your legs front to back and things, versus now you see a lot of these clips. There's, like you said, there's very little full long strides for a long period of time. You often hear people ask about it too, even for practices, about doing like full length skating straight line drills. You watch these clips, you see maybe a couple, some crossovers, some powerful crossovers, sometimes to gain speed. And then you see a wide stance and C cuts a lot. And then through pressure, you see C cuts, tight turns, Mohawks kind of thing. And you see maybe a couple of strides in between from a wide stance, right? So what are we working on here?
Yeah. Right? So Ben brings up a really good point. This is kind of probably, if I had to put one thing in hockey, we teach these long strides. We think that we're going to get power, and yet even, you know, when we race around the rink, we're going the length of the ice and big circle around the ice. Just watch the game. How many guys carry the puck that far? And I'm going to say something here. So Sidney Crosby does his cutbacks back and forth. He probably handles the puck almost more than just about anybody in the NHL because of what he does. He cuts back a lot. But in the total of a game, I don't know the actual number. He's somewhere around a minute and 34 seconds handling the puck in the course of the game. What is he doing for the rest of the 60 minutes? Okay, maybe he's only playing 25 minutes. What the heck? What's he doing? Truth is, guys, it's explosive. It's fast. You've got to move to the puck. You're supporting the puck. And in reality, the amount of time you get to do full-length strides down the wing is going to be 1% of the time, maybe, if you're lucky. Most of the times you're doing short bursts, quick accelerations, quick explosive, change of directions. That idea that we're into this game about going full length of the ice, that might happen when you're a really good player in mites and you got the full length ice. Well, that's no longer there. We've shortened the ice because that's the game. The game is short, explosive bursts. And even when you get to squirts, so some of you guys like Shane, you're going to move up into squirts. Reality is you could be really fast, but there's going to be a lot of things that are going to play to your game. And that's to be able to move laterally, able to move at any time, cut backs, and use with speed. Now let's maximize the ice surface. Let's use the full ice and fool guys and force them to come out to you so you create more space and time. Again, that's skating. That's footwork.
Yeah, so that's great. So interesting. So then, and then the foundation of that comes down to that's the strength in your stance, the strength in your position, and then the strength in each foot and each edge control and able to make those quick adjustments, quick turns, quick deceptions, shifts side to side, slow down, speed up with your edge control as you're skating. You talk about that a lot too. You talk about deception. Ken Martell, when he visits with us, talks a lot about Pat Kane too.
Yeah.
And how he's able to come down full speed on a defender and then just change his pace without,
unbelievable,
you know, without really making any kind of tells for the defenseman to realize, to just all of a sudden slow down and then be able to cut to an open space. from his strength in his edge control.
So let's talk about that, because one of the great things, so here we are, we talk about acceleration. This is really important. Acceleration is critical, but there's only so much ice in the game. And I'm telling you now, guys get to the blue line in the NHL with a little bit of speed, they can get on top of the goalie in two strides. It's incredible how strong they become and how fast they become. So one of the great things that Patrick Kane does is decelerate. He takes high-end speed, and he's coming, and his hands are moving so fast, and it mesmerizes guys. And then all of a sudden, he slows up. And they've got into pace, and they were backing up, and all of a sudden, he slows down. And they're still backing up. He's created space. Now he's got decisions to make. And now they're stuck in no man's land. And how many times have you seen it? You watch Patrick Kane videos. He's now slowed him down. Well, guess what just happened? He can go sideways. He laterally moves to the side. He pulls across, sucks guys in. He looks like he's going to shoot. Oh, nope, not that one. Whoops, shoot. Nope, not that one. Whoa, there's one. Boom. By that time, goalie's down. Everybody's sitting there. But we forget. We always think Patrick Kane, oh, his big secret is his stick handling. Oh, yeah, he's a phenomenal skater. But underrated, his skating. His skating is actually one of the best. And Johnny Gaudreau is another great stick handler. But Johnny Gaudreau, it's in his skates. He's wide skater. He sets guys up so they don't even know what they're doing. They're in a standstill position as he comes in. And then he sucks them in. So this is why we need to understand our edge work. This is the age you've got to get there, because learning it as you get older is tougher. This is where we get that technique and that flexibility and all these things, and we get into good habits. Those good habits of the proper skating stride and that low knee bend, I call it, it's like having suspension, always a nice soft cushion as you skate down the ice. Your legs are soft and comfortable, and that upper body's not going nuts. Look at Sidney Crosby. His upper body was totally in control. Evgeny Kuznetsov, the arms were moving, but the chest was in control over the center of the body, over top the skates.
Right. And then so maybe, Darren, maybe for the last few minutes here to finalize is some things, too, that players can be doing at home now and also as even when we're back. You talked about rollerblading being a great way to work on your skating strength and things. A lot of this, we talked about the kind of fundamentals of the stance. And the strength in each leg. It sounds like a lot of this can, you know, the leg strength in general, and you've given some, you've had, you know, Matt's done some workouts for us and some jumps and squats and things like that. That foundation of, you know, even if you do, Tom, do a private skating lesson once a week, the foundation of that leg strength and core strength and stuff, it sounds like it's a huge part of this.
It really is. It really is. I'm just looking for something here and I don't think I have it, but there's something new coming in that, and there's some new videos we just did, and there's a word that's coming along in sports today, and it's connectivity. Your feet and hands and your body are all interconnected in that multi-link combination. Your hands are moving one way, your feet are doing something else. And this connectivity is really important. So we've done a couple of stick handling drills that are up and coming. There'll be side straddle, side to side. The stick handling's happening in front of you. Your feet are doing all this movement back and forth. And then we're going to do crossovers in front, crossovers behind. We'll start to do more drills that are based on dry land training, which will help you get stronger on ice. And these are drills that we've picked up through Connor McDavid. We've picked up through Steven Stamkos, Nikita Kucherov. And watching what they do in dry land is very important, because there's a reason. Here's the big difference. There's a reason they do everything they do. They're not out there just to take a place and collect a paycheck on the ice. They're out there to create opportunities. That's really what they're getting paid for. That's why they're the elite players. And that's why we know them. The key is what they're doing is challenging themselves in different situations. Create an obstacle course. There's something that's in that'll be coming up in your stick handling, which will be an obstacle course. Create something difficult for yourself. Create lots of different movements. Jump over a ball while you're doing it. Things like that. And that dexterity, that connectivity, that blockchain connection is what we're calling it, is critical for your development. And at this stage, Let me talk about age-appropriate training. And I just because Shane's name came up, we're going to use Shane again. At Shane, at your level, there's something that comes along that doesn't always seem to match as we get older, because as the older kids are on here, and you mentioned some older guys that are coming along, they're going to go through puberty, and that puberty is going to put a lot more muscle and strength and speed. These are going to be the things that are going to happen when you get older, sort of that what I call 13 to 16 year old. But between 6 to 10, there's something called suppleness, and that's soft hands. There's fluidity that comes into play. And this suppleness is absolutely incredible if you can develop it now. And it's tied in very closely with coordination, dexterity, and connectivity. And it allows you that softness. You know, you look at guys. I mean, I watch guys, and I think, has that guy ever missed a pass? And we talked about somebody that came up earlier. Nicholas Backstrom, I've never seen that guy miss a pass. Everything he touches gets on his stick. It's like glue. It sticks like anything he does, his hands and his shot to the net. And then he makes passes that are in, like, did he even touch that pass? Because he has suppleness. He's got smoothness. His hands flow. And hey, look, no wonder the Capitals want to sign the guy to an amazing contract at his age, because he's got 500 of Ovechkin's, he's got 500 assists all delivered to Ovechkin. And nobody else puts the puck on his stick like he does. There's something in that fluidity, and that's all connectivity. Makes sense?
Yeah, it's a good point on the age-appropriate, Darren. Yeah, 10U, 12U, golden age of skill development. That's when those brains are really receptive to picking up the new skills and getting the right repetitions and really mastering those skills. And then, like you said, Darren, as they get older, and the strength and the power start to come in, developing that piece of it as well. Well, great. Okay, guys, we'll wrap up. I'll see if Coach Darren's got any final comments. And then, again, if you find this video valuable, please give us a share so the more people get to see it. Write us some comments or questions if you didn't get on, you're watching the replay and you want some things addressed in the future, because we're going to continue to schedule more lives in the future of different topics and things that come up as well. And Darren, if someone wants to get in touch with you with questions about skating or anything else, we're working on the treadmill, anything like that, I'll put your email in here. Anything else, any other things to say to the group before we sign off?
No, it's great. I enjoy this, and we'll probably do another one coming up. I'll be able to pull some more highlights. If you think that's worthy, you like to see some highlights, some videos. I do this anyway. I'm always looking, and I want to put some things into perspective. I'll even show potentially in the future how the power play is improved immensely. We all know high-skilled players, but it's improved immensely by this deceptiveness and this ability to move your skates and deceive. And we'll talk about that. But if those videos make sense, I'll continue to show video and have discussions on this for you. So please give feedback that way.
Okay, great. Okay, thank you, everyone. We will be talking to you soon. Reach out with questions or comments. And thanks so much.
Thanks, Ben. Thanks, guys. Talk to you later.